Let's now talk to architect Dan Lichauco, who is among the hospital design experts tapped by government to convert public buildings into quarantine facilities. He's the principal partner of Archeon Architects. Good morning, sir, and thank you very much for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Christian.
Okay, first, let's start with the projects that you're involved in. How many projects or existing facilities are being converted into quarantine facilities?
Well, we just finished Rizal Memorial, the Ninoy Aquino Stadium, and then the PICC, and the first government center in Clark. And then another group worked on the World Trade Center.
So in total, the projects or the facilities that you have converted, how many in total will be accommodated in terms of patients?
I think we're including Clark, it's about 1,500 beds. In Manila, it will be about a little over 1,000 beds.
Okay, let's talk about the procedure here, because we know that it's not easy to actually come up with such facilities because you're dealing with a highly infectious disease here. So what is the process involved here in terms of conversion?
Well, first of all, we had to understand what we were building. And so when we looked at the patient profile, the kind of people that will be using these facilities, we looked at that, and then we pulled out the World Health Organization manual for COVID-19 facilities. And so we're basically following the World Health guidelines, plus the DOH guidelines. And in those guidelines, one of the key instruments of preventing contamination is a thing called dilution, wherein we are diluting the air inside the facilities. We're changing the air as fast as we can. And we are also diluting the air when we expel it to the outside.
And what else? Because of course you need to come up with the proper spacing, right?
We're following the spacing. Mm-hmm. In fact, there are two cubicle types. The first one is a 2.4 by 2.4 by 2.4 high, which is basically two plywoods, no? It's 2.4 meters. And that's 8 feet high, so that when you're in the cubicle and you cough, it doesn't go to the next part of the room, or it doesn't go to the next cubicle. Mm-hmm. And so the sizing was really important for us. And the spacing of the beds are 2 meters apart, which is within the guidelines of both DOH and World Health. Mm.
And how long does it take usually for a facility to be converted into a quarantine facility?
Well, it's interesting because we finished everything in like 5 days. So as we were doing the drawings, the different contractors were building their parts. So 7 days max, and I think first patient will be there in Rizal and in the different facilities starting tomorrow. They're ready to receive the patient. Mm.
And what are the other considerations aside from bed spacing, for example, the need to isolate patients that are suspected to have COVID or those who actually have COVID already?
Well, one of the things we have to understand is you're both working designing for the patient, but you're also designing for the staff. So we had to make sure all of the back of the house facilities are there, the nurses' stations are there. In PICC and in the sports complexes, we color-coded the beds so that if you are in a purple cubicle, you know that you go to the purple nurses' station, and there's a green cubicle, you go to the green nurses' station. That way we can make sure that the nurses know what is their scope, where they have to work. And it's also clear for the patients to be able to go to what nurse station they're together with. Other things is we have a nurse call system, which is similar to the airline stewardess call system. You flip a switch, a light will turn on in the corridor, and then the nurse has to come in to talk to you and then disengage or turn off the switch to know that you've been served. And the other ones are we have outlets for people to charge their devices. To make sure that, you know, while they're there, they're as self-entertaining as possible, because we try to make sure that they limit their movement within the facility.
So one of the things that you considered also is the movement of personnel within the facility, right? So you limit the contact between the patient and so many, let's say, health workers. But how about, for example, preventing cross-contamination in terms of properly placing certain areas in that facility?
Well, since everybody's there already who is COVID positive, has been diagnosed as COVID positive, it's called cohorting, where you can put people with the same diseases in the same room. And so the cross-contamination between the patients is no longer an issue. What is an issue is contamination from patient to staff. Mm. And to do that, all the nursing stations are wrapped in plastic, there are HEPA filters in the nursing stations. when we can do outside nursing stations, we'll do outside nursing stations, depending on the facility that we're designing.
Now, you mentioned that it took you at least basically 5 to 7 days, so basically less than a week or maximum of 1 week to convert these facilities into quarantine facilities. Now, what was the most challenging part here?
A lot of it is, well, in the beginning, we had to make sure that we were designing the particular standard. So we looked at that and we looked at the World Health standards, and that's what we're designing for. And they do meet the DOH standards as well, so we're looking at both standards. The second is, it's kind of MacGyvering, I think, is when we design it based on what material is available. So each contractor building a particular site can tell us, Dan, this is the material we can find, can we use this? So we change things along the way. And third is sourcing materials, so that, sourcing the people so that they can get this done fast. So what we did is, as we were finishing the drawings, they were building it. And so it was a very simultaneous kind of effort all around to produce the 1,000 beds in under 10 days. So,
and by the way, where and how did you source the materials? And number two, the other important question is, when it comes to the workers who actually were involved in the construction, how did you make sure that they would also be exhibiting proper social distancing during the construction phase?
Well, all the workers were wearing masks, that's number one. Number two, we confined the workers into the work site, so they don't go home. They were fed, they were there until everything was finished, which was also easier for them. And three, there were foot baths and misting tents before you enter your facility. So that way, we knew that everybody there was uninfected or more or less most not symptomatic. And so within that facility, with the distance as well, so we were able to hopefully not spread any disease or the virus within the workforce.
Now, does it follow that, let's say you're dealing with a stadium, let's say with a big basketball court, for example, so it's a vast, it's a big space, it's much easier to build something there instead of, let's say, converting an existing structure with certain dividers already. So this one is much easier, is that correct?
Well, yeah, because one, it's for COVID positive. If we were designing something for POIs and POMs, schools with divisions would actually be nicer, and fresh air would be better, because fresh air or natural ventilation is the better way to prevent cross-contamination. And so when you have POIs who are not sure whether they're positive or not, diluting the virus in fresh air is the fastest way. These are air-conditioned facilities. And so this is when we decided that the air-conditioned facilities will be used by the COVID positive. Mm.
And also we've been hearing, there was this recent study abroad saying that, or claiming that, for example, the virus could travel twice the distance of ordinarily under ordinary circumstances if that is situated in a hospital. How did you address this particular concern, for example, in those facilities that were converted?
One of the things is that the data shows that the biggest the transfer of the virus is through droplets, which is the heavy parts. Then you're looking at the floating particles, which is the lighter parts. And so what happens is if we evacuate the air and we change the air as fast as we can, then those droplets or the floating parts will hopefully dissipate. Christian, let me give you an example. Ninoy Aquino is designed for 6,000 people. That means the air conditioning there is designed to expel the carbon monoxide of 6,000 people. We are only putting in 116 people altogether. So you're looking at a facility that is designed to serve 6,000 people, but then we're only using it for 116 people. And so you can see how clean and how dissipated the virus will be given those volumes.
So that is a basic idea. If you have a very big space and you have a fewer number of people situated inside, that would actually favor the people inside in terms of managing a virus like this.
Yes, and plus we're changing the air. So a traditional air conditioning system will have fresh air coming in, and we expel the bad air. So we're expelling the bad air as fast as possible by increasing the fresh air inflow into the facility.
And usually, how often is the facility disinfected? Let's say it already becomes operational.
It should be disinfected per patient. So what will happen is every time, because what they're trying to do is is leave the, make sure the patient can stay in their cubicle. But again, since everybody's infected, disinfectant per patient is fine. But what we're looking at is we are disinfecting the garbage as it goes out. We're disinfecting. The staff will have to go through makeshift airlocks so that they can be sprayed down after they leave the facility. So they come in, they put their PPE in a clean facility, then they do their work, then they leave their spray down, and then the PPEs are cleaned after. So it's a whole process of movement so that we make sure that people, staff, the cleaning staff, the medical staff are protected, and they follow the procedures, and we make sure that nobody else gets contaminated.
And how about the used mask and other personal protective equipment? What is the process of disposal?
That'll go into yellow bags. Yellow bags are basically infectious waste within the hospitals, and then those bags will be sent to the companies that do it for hospitals, and so the waste will be disposed of properly. Mm. I wanted to also add that we wanted to make this as comfortable as possible for the patients. So within their whole little cubicle, you know, there's a table, there's a chair, food will be delivered, food will be picked up. And that way, they can basically stay in this healing environment and get healed as fast as possible.
Now, of course, this is a temporary facility to house COVID-19 patients. Now, is there any special arrangement when it comes to the conversion, meaning you built these facilities knowing that that they are temporary?
Yes. Well, when this is all over, hopefully soon, we will tear it down and it will go back to normal within 3 or 4 days after the last case. As a temporary facility, we have to build it fast. We have these materials available. And then when it's back to a normal, then everything will just be dismantled.
Then what happens to the facilities, in particular, let's say the hospital beds? Where will they go?
The hospital beds are coming from different places, like Rizal Memorial, we're borrowing the beds from the Coast Guard. And so there are different places, and I think they'll be donated, hopefully, to the public institutions that will need them.
But these are brand new facilities or equipment, let's say the
some
beds?
Some of them are new, some of them are donations, some of them are not. So it's a mix of basically everything that we can get to provide for the 1,000 beds.
Finally, are you also involved in the conversion of the Philippine Arena into a quarantine facility?
Not the Philippine Arena. We're doing 3 other facilities. Hopefully we'll start construction Monday. The Philinvest Tent and Ultra is one of the things. And we're doing one for the city of Taguig as well.
So when are those facilities expected to be completed in terms of conversion?
We expect to start construction on Monday. and then hopefully by Thursday or Friday as well.
Okay, Architect Lichauco, thank you very much for joining us this morning, sir.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.